In this glass house lives one of the biggest, stinkiest, most famous plants alive. And it smells like rotting flesh. You might not recognize it right now because you've probably only seen pictures of it looking like this.
Amorphophallus titanum is one of the largest flowers in the world, and its scientific name literally translates to giant misshapen phallus. So David Attenborough famously shortened the name to Titan arum, but a lot of people know it as the corpse flower.
Unfortunately, being the biggest, smelliest flower in the world is putting it on the brink of extinction.
What the f***?
Native to Sumatran rainforests, this giant flower is called Bunga Bangkai by locals, which also means corpse flower. In Sumatra, the corpse flower is surrounded by myths. Some locals believe it can swallow people whole, or that it contains a sacred stone that cures diseases. Sadly, these fears are playing a part in the plant's destruction. But this destruction is nothing compared to the damage caused by palm oil plantations and timber harvesting.
It's estimated there's only about 1,000 corpse flowers left in the wild.
So if we were to leave a species that's endangered in the natural habitat that it exists, predation, land clearing, land use change, these are all the sorts of things that can actually threaten a species. By bringing it into an ex situ collection in a botanic garden, it means that we're able to understand how the species grows, what are the relationships it has with other species in the environment, whether they're plant or animals, so pollinators for instance, and then we can make sure that we can do the best we possibly can to replicate that if we are to introduce it back into its natural habitat.
As manager of living collections and conservation at Botanic Gardens of Sydney, Damien's role is to continuously improve how the garden sources, curates, and utilises the living collections across the three botanic gardens to help conserve plants like the Titan arum.
It's one of those species that everyone gets really excited about because it's large, it's very colourful, it's very bright, and it stinks.
The corpse flower's up to 3 metre tall height, colour and pungent smell is designed to keep it alive. While it might send humans running for the hills, this stench is like a fine perfume designed to lure insects, such as carrion beetles and flies, to the plant. Tricked, the insects think they've found a carcass to lay their young. Instead, they've unknowingly become pollinators. After fumbling around inside, they leave, covered in pollen, hopefully off to deposit their newly acquired luggage to another corpse flower, which will then be fertilised and produce fruit.
We're in the nursery right now, and the nursery is a part of the living collections, but it's an area that the general public don't get to see. Within the nursery, we not only propagate plants for the botanic gardens, but we also just maintain collections that might be critically endangered.
Kate Wilkie knows firsthand the important role botanic gardens and their living collections play in the fight against the extinction of plants like the corpse flower.
We're in T12 at the moment, which is a glass house that houses our aroid collection. And a part of that collection, of course, is the Titan arum. All of our examples here in the glasshouse are currently in leaf stage. They range from pot sizes of 175 mils all the way up to big ones up to 100 litre pots. This here, what you see, is a leaf. People may see it as a trunk, but it's actually a leaf. And it basically turns yellow, starts to crumble down, and it'll just flop. And as it keeps doing that, the corm will get bigger and bigger, and then eventually it gets to sizes like this. We're hoping that these two specimens that we have here will eventually turn into a flower next season.
To reach a fully blooming flower, the Titan arum goes through a fascinating life cycle. Growing from a seed-like stage, known as the corm stage, it then sprouts a leaf and enters the leaf stage, where it gathers energy from the sun and stores it in the corm. After 12 to 18 months, the leaf falls over and dies, and the plant re-enters the corm stage, beginning the cycle again, repeating it for up to a decade until the corm has stored up enough energy for the plant to transition to the flower stage. Helping the corpse flower bloom takes a lot of careful cultivation and even more patience.
So we have 12 specimens in this glasshouse, and they need to be in here because where they're naturally from, it's warm and it's humid. So we need to replicate that temperature in here, roughly in winter between 21 and 24 degrees. And then in summertime, it goes between 21 and 32. If it gets too cold, what will happen is the plants will start to rot. On the day-to-day maintenance of the Titan arum, we check on the plants every morning. So every morning we check the temperature within the glasshouse and also the humidity within the glasshouse. All this data gets recorded just so it gives us a picture of the conditions that the Titan arum is living in. On top of that, we also fertilise the plant. So we do that on a fortnightly basis with a liquid feed. And then when it gets towards the end of its life cycle, we change the fertilisation to give the plant different nutrients. And then we stop watering the plant when it starts to die down. And we don't want to water the plant too much because then the corm would start to rot. And the corm is the big potato-looking thing that's buried underground. And each year, when it dies down, what we do is we remove it from the pot, then we give it a clean, we check to make sure there's no rotten spots, and then we repot it into a bigger pot. And this ensures that the corm can grow, and then hopefully we cross our fingers, and hopefully the next time it puts a shoot through, it's a flower spike.
The corpse flower undergoes incredible transformations and it spends most of its time in a leaf stage. In fact, it only blooms for a single day every 7 to 10 years.
Paul Nicholson, Manager of Volunteer Programs at Botanic Gardens of Sydney, witnessed the rare bloom firsthand all the way back in 2004 when the crimson flower bloomed for the first time ever at the Royal Botanic Gardens, Sydney.
It was a massive event for the gardens and very exciting for horticulturalists like me who'd been working at the gardens for a number of years. Even as you started to get close to the glasshouse, you could already smell the plant. We describe it to people on tours. I often think about if you got some wet teenage socks, throw that into a blender, then you get some cat food you've left under in the sun, whack that in your blender, and then get some day-old vomit, put that in the blender, blend it all up, rip the lid off, that's the kind of smell you're getting. It was actually stunningly beautiful as well.
Since the corpse flower first bloomed in 2004, it's occurred just three more times at the garden, twice in 2006 and once in 2008.
The Amorphophallus is one of those species that really captures people's imagination and helps us then to have more opportunity to tell stories about plant conservation more generally. When they did flower here, people were lining up to see them. And we're seeing that right around the world. Thousands of people will line up to see them in nurseries or in glasshouses at botanic gardens.
We had two bloom at the same time in 2006. And what was really great about those two plants is they were grown from leaf cuttings. And working out how to grow the plants from leaf cuttings was really pioneered here at the Botanic Gardens.
Preserving endangered plants like the corpse flower requires a global effort. And botanic gardens around the world have to unite in their dedication to preserving Earth's ecological diversity by sharing scientific discoveries and cultivation techniques.
Look, it's critical we work with other botanic gardens, both nationally and internationally. For instance, in Australia, we have approximately 26,000 flowering plants. So that's a huge number of species that we need to work with. We can't do it all ourselves. Likewise, other countries can't do it all themselves, even if they are native to their home country. Sometimes it's because we have experts that are working on particular families or a particular genera. That means that they've got the skills, the expertise, and the knowledge for how you cultivate and grow and look after these plants. It means we've got better opportunities to learn from each other and to contribute to each other's conservation practices.
Here at the Royal Botanic Gardens, Sydney, the ongoing preservation of the corpse flower is a direct result of these collaborations.
Well, it's estimated there's about 90 gardens and other organisations in about 18 countries around the world that are growing the titanum arum. Across that network of botanic gardens, there's a lot of work going on to understand how to cultivate them, how to grow them, but also how we can actually breed them to increase the genetic diversity of the species, with the hope that eventually we can introduce them back into the wild and support those collections that are growing in their natural environment. The kinds of information that we share with each other is the kind of soil profile that you would have it in a nursery, the kind of temperatures, the humidity that your glasshouse will have that in. It's not always published literature that helps us do our work. A lot of the time it's actually just experts talking to other experts. What have you tried? What failed? What worked?
The ongoing research in cultivating and preserving this unique plant has paid off, with hundreds of blooms now occurring at botanic gardens around the world since these efforts began.
What would really be great is if the specimens that we look after flower over the next few years, because that would just put all the effort and the time and love that the horticulturists have put into maintaining these plants. It would just be like the icing on the cake.
If we can have them flower again, that'd be great. And I do regular tours behind the scenes in our glasshouses, and we've been watching those stunning leaves get closer and closer to the ceiling of the glasshouse. So hopefully some of our plants are starting to reach that kind of magic weight of around 20 kilos where they might produce a flower.
The corpse flower is more than just a giant plant famous for its peculiar stench. It's a remarkable example of nature's ingenuity and the power of plants.
And even when it's not blooming, the corpse flower is fascinating throughout its entire metamorphosis. A truly remarkable species to behold and protect.
Subscribe to the Botanic Gardens of Sydney YouTube channel.